it. Yes, get in there. Come on. Yeah, check that out. It is the height of summer and I'm at Fields Lake in Abingdon in Oxford, and it's typical of day tickets and syndicates spread all over Europe. The fish have been hammered all spring on bright pop-ups, and now it's time to feed them and fish hard on the deck. This is the Bottom Baits Masterclass. So what counts as a bottom bait? It's basically anything where the hook is laying flat against the lake bed. A bottom bait straight out of the bag is the most basic option, but it can include a snowman rig, which is a bottom bait topped with a pop-up. You can also top it with a piece of plastic corn. You can drill out a bait and insert a cork stick to balance it. And of course, you can opt for a ready-made wafter. Wafters are usually made from a blend of normal base mix and pop-up mix. But this session, I'm starting with cork dust wafters, which perfectly match what I'm feeding. Wafters work so well because they negate the weight of the hook so it flies faster into the mouth. And they normally reset if they don't hook first time. If the underwater films have proven anything, it's that carp will mug you off at some point.
Oh, no!
So, if there's a slight buoyancy to the bait, the hook always lands perfectly back under the hook bait, cocked and ready for another bite. So when we arrived yesterday, it wasn't as windy as this, and it was a little bit sunny, a little bit warmer, and for some reason the fish were just turned on. They were showing all over the lake from one end to the other, and it was actually quite a dilemma where to go. They were showing off the end of the island up there, fizzing up, you know, it looked bang on for it. And if there hadn't been somebody in here who was catching, I probably would have gone up there. So when I started, I just cast the marker lead out, just no float at all, just the normal probe marker lead, and I just cast left and right of where he was actually getting his bites from to see how wide the area was, and it was really wide. So I just spaced all three rods out at 15 wraps, but before I did so, I put my bait out about, I think I put 9 spoms out at the start, and I was looking to try and get a bite yesterday evening. That didn't happen, which says to me that evening is not a bite time on here at the moment. And then I refreshed everything at first light this morning, swapped over to a spod instead of a spom because it makes less splash, and only put 2 out just to scare anything away that might have been out there. Got the 3 rods out in probably about 5 casts to do all 3. Pretty much, I reckon 2 hours afterwards, that rod was away. Before getting the rod back on the spot, I put out 3 spods, as it's always better to scare the fish away with food rather than the rig. Even though the spot is wide, it's important to make sure to feel for a decent drop, so I'm using 12 pound contour fluorocarbon, as it's got very little stretch, so it transmits every bit of information about the spot right up to the rod, and it sinks like a brick. I've coupled it with a 1/4 ounce back lead, so I can fish relatively tight lines. Set up like this, the fish hook themselves against the tight line as much as they do against the lead. This swim has been weed rake recently, so I've got a really nice big channel right up to the spot where my lines can be pinned down completely out of the way. Now, I've used wafters in loads of different guises all over Europe. Gigantica is ruled by wafter fishing and bottom bait fishing because the fish are so switched on to feeding on the bottom, far more than they are in the UK. And you find that a lot in foreign waters because the fish are bottom feeders, they never get caught off the surface. You just seem to get more bites on bottom baits than you do on pop-ups. I've used them all over the UK as well, and at this time of the year when the fish have really been hammered on pop-ups, they are my first line of attack if I can find a clear spot. So during this session, we're going to show you how to find the clear spots to fish the rigs on. We're going to show you the rigs to fish over the top of them, the baiting strategy as well, and hopefully we're going to catch some amazing carp in this fantastic venue. Only been about 5 minutes since recasting the middle rod, and the right hand rod is away. When I put that out earlier, got a really soft drop at the start, and I just wound him straight back in, didn't take it out the clip, and recast it and just pulled the rod a little bit more towards me, just a couple of feet, and it went down with a lovely thud. And I'm suspecting there's a little bit of silt or silk weed at the back of the area. And if you leave it when it doesn't feel right, that can be a rig snarled up in weed, or especially if you're fishing with a bottom bait and you're not going to get a bite on it. So feeling for the drop is so important whenever you're carp fishing, but when you're fishing with bottom baits, it's even more important. That fish has just passed right over the top of them other two lines, and this is the benefit of the back leads. If you fish the rod tips low and the line's tight, when the fish comes in close, you can get in all kinds of problems. So what I tend to do is, I'm fishing tight lines and no back leads, I tend to have the rods quite high, so when the fish gets in close, you can play it underneath the lines. But where I've got them back-leaded here, I want the tips nice and low, so the line's out in a straight line without an angle in it as much as possible. Looks to me like one of Simon Scott's finest, VS scaly one. Come on, you are mine. Get in that net. Got him. Yeah, man, what an absolute pearler. Look at that. Just shy of the magical 20-pound barrier, but who cares when they look like this? And this one was taken on the Match the Hatch dumbbell wafter. Fished really close to the deck. I like to use really short hairs when I'm fishing over bait. And it's just enough to stand out, you know. It's got a little bit of white squid bill on it, which is an absolute winner. And I think it just stands up that little tiny bit. So it may get taken early, but it's definitely not enough to start them.
With the midday sun high in the sky, bite time feels like it's over. What I've learned over the years is having bait in the water with no lines can be a massive edge. So if you're not feeling it, wind in, bait up, and give the fish a chance to come back into the area. I had another big bream this morning, so I reckon I've got no bait left on the spot. I'll switch from a spod to a spawn because it gets more bait out quickly and creates more splash, hopefully attracting the fish back in that have drifted away from the area.
The mix I'm using is sort of my go-to mix at this time of the year if I'm not using particle. And the basis of that is always pellet. And that's because the fish on this lake and a lot of other embryo lakes are fed pellet a lot of the year. It's very, very good for growth. And a lot of the syndicates feed it in between when the anglers are fishing. So the fish really know it. And they absolutely love it as well. It's very absorbent. I've just soaked it a little bit, thrown some of the flake maize over the top, which is a really nice sort of added sort of visual thing to your mix. Then it's also very, very absorbent. So anything that you put on it, whether it be water or oil or smart liquid, or in this case, I've put chili sauce all over it, it really soaks it up if you dilute it with a bit of water. And just those two would be a great base to any mix, or a mix on its own. And then to that, I've added two different kinds of boilie. I've added the fish meal that I'm developing with Mainline at the moment. It hasn't got a name yet. That's sort of a classic fish meal, no colouring, not loads of synthetic flavour in there, loads of goodness. And everywhere I've used it, I've done really well on it. So I've got high confidence in that bait at the moment. So that's the basis of my boilie. And then also link, because I've used link on here a few years ago and did really well on it. And obviously that's a bait that you can now buy straight out of the shop. So I've mixed the two, 10 millers and 15s, crushed some up as well, not loads. I think if you only put crushed boilie out, you can find yourself in problems where the fish are sieved in little tiny items. You've got, in this case, a 15mm pellet out there, 12mm in diameter, 15mm long, and that may be too big for the crumb that they're feeding on. So by having several different sizes of food in that mix, and some whole boilies and some crumbed up boilies. I'm just creating as much attraction as I possibly can, and making sure that the fish don't become preoccupied on really small items. And onto that boilie, once I've crushed it and mixed it, I've added a smart liquid that matches up with the fish meal bait. That's been a revelation in my fishing in the last couple of years. I've fed my fish in my tank at home on it, and they went absolutely doolally, both in the winter and the summer. They eat everything much faster. They carry on sifting around the tank for hours and hours afterwards, looking for little grains of food. And on one occasion last winter, there was actually some little tubes of fish from the day before. That was sitting in the bottom of the tank. And after feeding them with boilie and flake maize that had been soaked in the smart liquid, they ate all their own. Can you believe that? It isn't just a gimmick. I have seen evidence with my own eyes in the tank and in my fishing that the fish really, really love it. So that's my mix, probably 60% pellet, you know, with a little sprinkling of the flake maize, 40% boilie. If I get loads more bream problems, I'll drop the pellet out and just fish with pure boilie. But for now, I'm happy with the chances I've had thus far. I'm sure tomorrow morning we'll get more. But if you want a mix that's going to attract fish in, you know, and keep them there for long periods, that's what I recommend.
A new dawn and a new swim. I had another big bream at first light and that was it, so I'm certain they've done the off. When your gut tells you the carp have moved, you have to as well. I've moved from one end of the lake to the other into a swim I've never fished before called the Snake Pit. The guy in here had four last night, which is all the indication I need that the fish are up this end in numbers. As soon as I got eyes on the swim, I could see them bubbling up in more than one spot.
It's fizzing now, look, that's fizzing. Yeah. Look, have you got that in shot?
Yeah.
There's two massive weed rafts up here that are clearly holding fish, and it just goes to show, if your action has dried up, go for a walk and see what's occurring elsewhere.
It's very weedy off to my left as well, but I've had a good cast round and I found a really nice area out there. I say I got tipped off about it. I'm fishing at 23. I've got nice firm drops on the left hand rod and the middle rod. And I made sure I cast around with just the marker lead on the end of the marker rod first of all, saw what the drops were like, felt them down. And it basically gets softer the further you get away from the island. So I've changed my rigs around a little bit. I've put a helicopter rig on the right hand rod because it is a little bit softer with a very, very short 20 pound boom hook link. And then next to that, I've got lead clips on the other two rods, but I've changed from running lead clips to hybrid lead clips. And the idea behind that is that they will dump the lead when the fish runs off away from me. I haven't got really tight clutches on the reels, so the fish can run. As they run, hopefully the lead will come off, the fish come up in the water, and then if they do go around the back of those sort of floating weed beds out there, I've got a lot more chance of getting them in. The other thing about swapping onto the claw hooks on all rods is they're more secure. A beaked pointed hook is going to stay in better than a straight pointed hook. I do love the long shank X's in a size 6, but you can just tell it's a bit too brutal out here to fish with that kind of hook. So I've changed my approach around a bit. I've already put 10 spombs out at 23 wraps, exactly the same as my fishing rods. That would have dropped the bait behind where the fishing rods are sitting on the bottom. And I just want a little bit of bait to draw the fish into the area. And then I've done one turn on the spod reel and re-clipped it to bring it back about 3 foot. And that should drop all of the bait I'm going to put out now on top of the rod. So got a little bit behind to draw them in, and then the bulk of the bait is there, and they're spaced pretty close together. I would say 3 to 4 foot apart, maybe the right hand rod's slightly more right than I wanted it by a couple of foot, but the drop was lovely. I'm going to spread the bait right out, and I was thinking if I can get them going and keep feeding that area. I'm still using wafters, but until I start getting bites consistently, it's difficult to mess around. So 20 more out now and we'll see how it goes. taking me in and out of weed, well, through weed. I can just feel him charging through the other side of some weed out there.
When a fish gets weeded up solid, you've got two options. The first is to put the rod back down on the rests and let the fish pull itself out of the weed, as they often do. That takes a lot of patience, but it does work. The second option, if you've got to pull a fish through loads of weed and it's still moving, is to just inch back. So rather than dropping the rod and winding, you just inch back 1 foot behind the other in the swim and you'll get the fish moving. You then wind yourself back to the front of the swim and then just step back and just inch yourself back. And doing it that way keeps a constant pressure on the fish, can get it moving, and often a huge raft of weed will come back towards you.
He's in.
Once the fish is in the net, you can end up with a load of weed to get rid of, and it's much better to do that while the fish is in the water than lift the whole lot out together, because you can end up compressing the fish underneath all the weed, and you can also end up breaking your landing net. So I just have the landing net open, I'll get down as close to the water as I can, and just carefully just take the weed off of the line, just keep pulling it apart, rather than tugging it really hard. If you just shake it, you'll find it will just come free of the line, come free of the line, and then with a small amount of weed left in the net, you'd put the weigh sling in, close the net up, slide it into the weigh sling, and take the fish out of the water in the weigh sling rather than in the landing net. It's much safer for the fish that way, and there's far less chance of ripping the hook out of the mouth. It's something that I do every single time I land a fish.
There we go. Awesome little 15 pounder. Gorgeous, gorgeous fish. Sure, it'll get big one day and probably be a 30 or even a 40. But the most important thing is a bite in the daytime, only 2 hours after putting 30 spombs in. I'm not surprised it's come on the right-hand rod because the fish are to my right. And I think they're coming out of that open water towards me that way. But it proves that the helicopter rig is presenting the hook baits really well. Exactly the same hook bait as in the last swim. But just a 4-inch hook link, the bead up the leg core about 3 or 4 inches just so the leg can plummet in. It was quite a soft drop, but it was obviously presented because the hook was about 1 inch back in the mouth. So that one's going to go back out there probably in about an hour. I'm going to see if the other rods go. If nothing happens, I might even switch a second rod onto the helicopter rigs just to be sure that they are presented. They went down with nice drops, but it's little things like that, just swapping your rigs around to suit the substrate, that will keep you getting bites no matter what.
I spent the remaining hours of the day behind motionless stows, so I decided to put out another 20 spombs to top the swim up for the night. The rigs and baits were working, so there was no need to change anything there, and in the very early hours of the morning, I was in. It did exactly the same as the last fish, weeding me up solid, so I followed the same procedure of slowly walking back in the swim, and a few minutes later, I was able to slip the net under a banging linear.
The only one of last night, just shy of 20 pound, and weeded me up solid, just like the one did yesterday afternoon. And this one cleared the weed and fought a bit under the rod tip. Because I'm fishing the rod tips up in the air, I was able to play it underneath and not get caught in the other lines. But they're all out there sweet now. It's looking good for a bite. I've just seen one show away from the area, and the guy opposite has just caught one as well. So that means it's bite time. So when you're seeing that happening around the lake, you want to sit on your rods, don't recast, don't rebait, just sit there and wait for it to happen. But for now, I'm a very happy man. Gorgeous, gorgeous fish. And I'm sure there'll be more to come.
Fluorocarbon lines have loads of advantages, but can be a little harder to use due to their wiry nature. Contouring 12 pounds is my all-time favourite because it has so little stretch, it's virtually indestructible, casts far better than the higher breaking strains, and like all fluorocarbons, it sinks like a brick. There are simple steps to reverse wear and tear and make it easy to use from day one. So, starting with spooling up.
One spool of contour needs a little bit of backing, so I do about 70-80 turns of just some old line that I've got on another reel, then tie the contour on, and it'll basically fill it perfectly up to the top. Now I've had this contour on for probably 12 months, something like that, and I fish with it a lot. I fished all last winter with it. It sinks like an absolute brick. It's much, much tougher. So that's 033 diameter. It's much tougher than an 035 line in normal mono. You feel the bottom really well on it as well because it's very, very low stretch. But like I say, coming off the distant six repeatedly, like all lines, you can get a little bit of twist in it. So what I've done with it during this session, I've used my mate Lance, walked it out behind the swim. We've got a lovely straight area at the back of these swims. So I've taken the lead and the hook link off. He's gone one way, I've gone the other way until we've got probably 100 yards apart. And then I've really put it under some pressure, really pulling it back towards me, really, really stretching it, you know, for sort of the count of maybe 20 seconds, you know, before I'll ease off the pressure. And then I go back to Lance just a little tiny bit so it doesn't ping out of his hand. And then he drops the lead system with minus the lead. And then I wind it back through my little bit of foam. So I'm basically pushing all the twists out of it and cleaning the line at the same time. Where you've stretched it, it goes more limp and you get even better response when the lead hits the bottom. And then throwing it out here to 23 wraps, even into the wind, is an absolute breeze. And you'll see I'm fishing the bobbins right at the top. The lines are reasonably tight, but because I've got the stow bobbins really close to the buzzer, there's less weight pulling down on the line. I don't like there to be any sort of drop on the bobbin at all. I want the fish to hook itself against the tight line as much as it does against the rig. So once I've cast out, sunk the line, I'll get the lines really, really tight so they're all pointing straight to the spot. Where it's windy here and you've got weed floating around, you don't want one line going over the top of the other. When they're all dead straight, I'll pay a bit off, and what will happen is that fluorocarbon will sink near the rig, I'll pay a bit more off, and it will continue to sink. So the line's still pretty tight, but the bit near the rig is on the bottom, the bobbin's right at the top, so there's no movement whatsoever, it's straight onto that rod, straight onto the tight clutch, and I think that hooks a lot more fish. If you're getting funny takes, or you're getting little pulls up on the bobbin and they're not converting, screw everything up a bit tighter, have the bobbin really close to the buzzer, and I bet the next one will absolutely roar off.
We have moved again. We are now in swim number three. This one's called the boat swim. And the reason we're here is the fish are here, basically. Didn't fish last night, wanted to get up early, have a look round. It just didn't feel like I was going to get more than one chance a day in that other swim. It was all happening on the right hand rod. The fish were basically coming out from the centre of the lake. The other swim's just on the other side over there, the snake pit. They were coming that way. The right hand rod was going. It was spooking the rest of the fish back out into the main body of the lake, and that was the end of the action. So knowing that and having a couple of days left of the session, I thought I'd go for a walk round this morning. If you haven't got rods in the water, you're more open to choosing a different swim. I put a little bit of bait in the point swim at the other end of the lake last night. Had a look at that this morning. Absolutely nothing out there whatsoever. Saw some bubbling sort of a little bit closer in, but there was nothing anywhere near the spot. And then looking back up the lake, I saw fish showing in front of here. So when I came round here, got the binoculars out, had a good look through the binoculars, and you could see fizzing everywhere. And that's a really good tip. When you could turn up and the lake is absolutely like glass, often you can't see bubbles that are 80, 90, 100 yards out into the lake. If you've got binoculars, you have a look at that same area and it's fizzing like you wouldn't believe. So always bring them with you when you're looking round. And then once I've got round here with the kit, I've cast the spod out, so the solid spod, the Skywinder, just with water in it, wrapped it at 18 wraps where Jeffrey runs the syndicate had told me was clear. It makes next to no splash as it hits the surface. And Lance was with me and he was pinpointing, was it the right range where the bubbles were coming up? And he said, no, that's short. So I wound it in, wrapped it up at 20 wraps, cast it again. He said, that's much more like it. So we knew we were the right range with no leads dropping through the water column. Because remember, the fish are out there, they're feeding. The last thing you want to do is put a big marker float out there, 4 ounce lead, bomb it to death. The fish are just going to dissipate. So once we got the range right, then I wound it in, looped it off, looped to loop on one of the pronged marker leads in 2 ounces, the lightest one we do, so it makes next to no splash. Flick that out to 20 wraps again and just feel it down. And at 20 wraps, unfortunately, it was just a little bit of weed out there. And those prong leads are so good because if there's any weed at all, you can feed it locking up in the weed, then it pulls free, you wind it in, and 9 times out of 10, there's a bit of weed around the lead. So when you're bottom bait fishing, they are an absolute edge. I use them up to 4 ounces when I'm fishing at long range at Gigantica. I always cast that out first. If that slides and doesn't lock up, then there is no weed there. A normal lead, even one of our probe marker leads, can cut through very thin bottom weed. You don't feel anything at all, you think that's clear, you wind in, there's no weed around the lead, put rigs on it, and then you start winding a little bit of weed on a hook and you haven't caught any fish and you're like, oh, then your brain starts going. Putting one of those pronged ones out of the start, if that slides and you come back with no weed around it, it is completely clear. So I did that a few times in the swim just to be 110%. 18 is the range that everyone fishes in here, but I've pushed it a bit further and got out to 20, you know, and I think just being that little bit further than everybody else, that's a spot that hasn't been exploited that could really produce dividends. Now, standing at the front of the swim, it was just into weed. So rather than re-clipping it, I just took just a step back and cast again, pulled the lead back a little tiny bit more, boom, and it went down onto lovely ground and then just slid along the bottom. And I thought, that is a spot. Cast slightly left of the tree that I'm aiming at. That was a little bit weedy there. Just inside the tree, boom, nice solid bottom, and it slid again. So I know my middle rod and right hand rod need to be in the middle of that tree and just to the right of it, and that's exactly the line the fish were bubbling on. And then I had to have a few more casts around with the left hand rod, and it was into weed, a little bit of weed around the lead when I wound it in. You can feel the resistance as you wind it in that there's weed on it. So I took another step back, so I'm halfway back down that little pontoon there, cast out again, sort of towards the other swim that's called the big log that's directly in front of here. Cast to the right hand side of it, a little bit of weed, bumped it out, all that was clear. Cast to the left hand side of it, still at 20, felt it down, bump, that's lovely. Slightly left of it, further still, it's even firmer. So there's sort of another harder area, I guess. If I went further and further left, there's another harder area, but I want to be on the edge of it. I don't want to be in the middle of the gravel. I want to be just on the edge of it. You remember when I was down at Scaffolds at the start of the session, all the bites came in the firm stuff, but not the gravel. So I'm trying to avoid gravel on this lake, just fish on the edge of it. Where it goes from gravel into silt, that is a brilliant area on any lake to get a bite. So a new swim is like a new woman. It's all exciting, the rods aren't out yet. I'm going to put a few casts out with a spawn first and just literally drop little bits of bait in. I want to try and get a bite today if I can, rather than just doing everything for tomorrow morning. So softly, softly over each spot, 3 or 4 spods, not spawns, so they make next to no splash. Just trickle a little bit of bait in, 3 casts out there, and we'll see what happens.
Perfect. Well, that is the happiest I've felt all session. The first two swims, I was following somebody in, and it never feels right jumping in someone's grave, but I don't really know that much about the lake. So following people in that have been getting bites and they've been kind enough to tell me spots, you know, it's definitely caught me fish. There's no doubt about that. For now, I think this is the best chance of multiple takes in the last few days of the session. So to talk about the spodding, I'm using a traditional spod rather than a spom, not for the sake of it, but I just thought in this situation, because there was a lot of fish out there, I'd put a smaller spod out with less splash, less food, and it's spread out a bit more. And what you'll notice is when it hits the surface, I've got the rod right forward, so it's actually dropping well behind the rig. And then you let the line go slack, count to 10, and some of it will fall out the bottom of the spod, but not all of it. And then I'll just give it a flick, and that flicks it towards me, and it's just flicking the end up, and as it sinks back down again, more will fall out. So you're just literally teasing it out of the spod, which is exactly what you want. It's just like being in the boat and sprinkling it out over a wider area. Now, obviously, if I was going to put a lot of bait in, if I knew the lake well and I knew a big hit of bait was what was needed, I would obviously swap to a spom, and probably a big spom to start off with. But in this situation, I think a little bit of finesse, spreading the bait out a little bit, is going to pay dividends. Just one last thing, I've got the rod tips up in the air, you can see in the background. That's not so it looks cool, although it does look cool.
I would like to be backleading in this swim, really, because there's not tons of weed going out there, but certainly in the margins there is weed. And if you backlead into weed, your line's still held up sort of in the upper layers of the weed. If the fish charges through the weed and goes under a backleaded line, you're in loads of trouble. So by having the tips up in the air, the line's fairly tight. The bobbins have got one weight on them, the stows, but they're pulled right up against the buzzer, so there's less weight actually pulling down on the line. So the fish is straight onto that rod tip as soon as it picks the rig up. But it just means you've got line on the bottom near the rig where you want it, and then closer in, the line is up in the water. And if I do get bites, when they come close in, I'm sure I'm going to be playing them left and right underneath the line. So everything is done for a reason. Let's see what happens. Well, we had a bet earlier on, what rod was it going to be? And I said the right hand rod. Proper motor in this fish. Proper motor in. Whoa! Big old Chinook going up there. I'd love to go up in one of them. He's doing me in the reeds. Mallard didn't like it. 20 pounder up his bum. This is the reason my tips are up in the air, so that I can play him underneath if he went off to the left in a split second. Come on, get in that net, come on. Yes, lovely. Good start. Proper cool one this, look, little tiny withered fins. Just about mid-double, but it's nice to be off the mark in a new swim and on a new hook bait as well. So the orange garlic is definitely going back out on that spot again. And I said that was the one that was going to go because it felt nice when the lead hit the bottom. It was just that sort of the sandy, muddy bottom. And it seems to be that he likes to feed over that more than the gravel. If you are fishing with bottom baits, learning to feel the lead down and knowing exactly what you're fishing on is a major, major part of it. And you need to practice, practice, practice until you know that you're in the right place. So the rigs I've been using during the session have sort of evolved depending on the swim I've been in. So scaffolds was a really hard spot, just at medium range, 15 wraps. And in that situation with not much weed around, I like to use a running rig if I can. I've been using them all winter long to really, really good effect on difficult lakes. And you can set it up a couple of ways. At the moment I'm using lead core. So I'm using a short length of lead core first of all, that's really important. I want to get off the lead core and onto the main line as quickly as possible. And the reason for that is the main line is much thinner and much more difficult to see than the lead core is. So the lead core is there as an anti-tangle device to stop the hook link tangling around the main line. And it's also there to protect the fish. So the lead core is running up and down the fish when you're playing it, rather than the line running up and down it and potentially flicking scales off. So I've got it looped to either end. I'll splice it basically and just leave loops in either end, and that makes it really versatile. In this situation, I've slid on a rubber connector and just a standard lead clip, and then I've looped to loop on a size 8 quick change swivel. But before I've done that, I've squeezed it with a pair of crimp tools just to make the eye slightly oval so it doesn't click into the lead clip. And basically act as a semi-fixed rig. It will pull out really, really quickly, and that means we've seen it on the underwater. When the fish pick it up, they shake their head, the lead starts to slide away from the fish, and no matter what they can do, there's no anchor point to get rid of the hook, and it just goes further and further away. They panic, and you get a steam intake. So on from that, attaching the hook link is literally just a loop that's crimped in the end of a bit of 15-pound boom. I started using that after Dovey absolutely smashed it on Crete Lakes for monster carp. And I just like scaling it down a little bit. When you're catching smaller fish and using smaller hooks, the 25 can be a little bit cumbersome. So 15 pound, about 6 inches long. I've got a small dark matter anti-tangle sleeve on the bit that's going to push up next to the leg clip. So I just hook it onto the crook in the quick change swivel, pull that up against it. It's all super, super neat. But most importantly, what it's doing is it's pushing the hook link away from the lead core when you're casting. And you see, if I've got a dark hook bait on, when I'm casting out, you can see the hook bait flaying backwards and forwards, miles away from the lead core. So if you're getting tangles with your rigs, I recommend you use an anti-tangle sleeve. It will push everything away and it should cure that for you. And then at the other end, I've got a spinner swivel, one of the PTFE coated ones. I've just cut the ring off of it just to have less metal at that end. And I've got a little tiny loop crimped into the end of the 15 pound boom. And then the hook is attached to that. So onto that, I put a medium kicker. I cut a little sliver off first, just so it's nice and neat when it covers up that spinner swivel. It goes on fat end first, and that slide that round the hook, making sure the point doesn't come out the side of it. It just goes on perfectly. Pull that down so it kicks in. And what I've done with the size 6 Longshank X's, I like the eye in turn even more. So I've just put the eye in the crimp tool and just put some pressure on it and just bent the eye inwards a little bit. And I think that helps it turn over and catch hold that little bit better. So you can see the kicker's coming out at a real aggressive angle. When you put it onto the spinner swivel and cover it up, it's sort of hanging out to the side and you can just see it wants to turn all the time. Now, attaching the bait, you can do it a number of ways. I like a soft hair, so I'm using 30 pound armour cord. I'm doing my favourite whipping knot, do a big loop underneath the hook, and then with the front of the loop, go around the hook once going up, and then cross it over going down, 6 more turns, pull it tight, and once you've got that really tight, that will not move up and down the hook. Obviously, cut the tag end off, then I just tie a simple overhand loop for the end of my hair, and I just measure the bait up against it to make sure it's the right length, do that, and it's perfect. So the second rig I've been using over in the snake pit swim is basically the same hooking arrangement. I did change from a Longshank X to a claw because it's got a curved in point and I think it's that little bit more secure. I shortened the hook link down because it was running on a leg core leader. So it was fished helicopter style, one of the mini heli safes on the end, which are an absolute thing of beauty. And about 3 inches up from that, I had the no trace bead. So it's a little tiny collar and a bead with a slit in it. When that pulls off of that collar, it just falls away because of the split, and then the hook link can get off the end. So it is super, super safe. If the lead doesn't come off on the take and the line snaps, then that bead will pull off and the hook link will slide off the leg core and away. And again, I've kept to a short length of leg core. Long lengths don't cast as well. And again, the shorter the length, the quicker you're onto the line and the less visible it is. And that short hook link sliding up and down the lead core allows the heavy 3.5 ounce lead to plummet into that soft bottom and then present the hook link nicely on top. And both the bites I had over there were on that rig on the right hand rod, which was closest to where the fish had been showing out in open water. So it definitely suited that situation and the fish were absolutely nailed. So the rigs I'm using are almost identical at the hook end and I'm just changing things around to suit the substrate that they're landing on.
Not knowing the swim meant the fish was allowed to take too much line on the take, and so it immediately weeded me up. And despite my best efforts, the walking back trick wasn't working this time. So rather than keep pulling and re-snapping the line, I put the rod back down on the rest, loosening the clutch to give the fish the chance to swim back out the weed. Patience is absolutely key here. The spool was still turning, so the fish was clearly still on. But no matter how hard I pulled, it would not come free. It was proper buried in the mother of all weed beds, so it was time for the last resort.
Lance has gone out in the boat, bless him. Obviously all life jacketed up, and he's gonna catch hold of the line and just pull himself out using the line, to pull himself out to the fish, and then pull the fish out of the weed directly up. Is it just engulfed in a massive weed bed? Just keep edging it back, edging it back, edging it back. But there's a huge ball of weed over it. I'm just trying to inch that in now. Just don't wanna, there's so much pressure on the line. And obviously the fish is still there as well. But I could have gone out in the boat with him, but I just wanted to minimise the amount of time we spent over the top of the area in the boat. And also, we might have been searching for a second life jacket, so it just made sense. It's what I do at Gigantica. I go out in the boat for the angler, and I free the fish for them, and then they carry on playing it. It's not engulfed in the weed on the bottom of the lake anymore, it's moving. I tell you what, try and clear some weed off of it. Can you see the fish? Oh my word. Well done, that man. It's in there, is it? Well, with a little help from my friends, good job there was a few of us here. Obviously, it ain't done a lot of fighting because it flat rodded me straight into the weed. Lance said, it's only a little ball, didn't ya? Oh my goodness. Is 30 pounds, 12 ounces. Get in there, oh my goodness. What a touch, with a little help from my friends. I don't think I would have got that in on the own. Wow, what a fish. Yeah man, look at that. 30 pounds, 12 ounces, that's more like it. Obviously, I would have liked to have done battle with him a bit longer, but that's the way it goes on weedy lakes. And the lesson here is I need to be on hybrid lead clips. So the lead dumps on the take, and that's going to make it much easier to get it back through that weed. So whilst the running rig is brilliant for getting a bite, if you have problems like that, they need to come off. But it's very easy, just loop to loop off the old lead clip, loop to loop on a hybrid one, and we're fishing again. So two of those are going to get changed over now, and definitely two rods are going on to the orange hook baits. That garlic supreme is an absolute winner most places I use it, and it was probably a mistake not to start using it at the beginning of the session. But that's the way it goes. I'm learning about the lake. It's only my fourth trip ever on here, so I'm learning as I go along. Everything's going to get written down, so when I come back again, I hit the ground running. But for now, I'm a very happy man. If you want to fish a slow sinking hook bait, there are loads of different options. When I'm fishing abroad, I tend to use wafters straight out the pot, normally from the Mainline high impact range, and I'll chuck a bit of goo over those as well, and I normally fish them in conjunction with quite a big hook and a small bait if I can get away with it, and maybe a size 4 long shank X or a size 2 curve D-rig kicker. You know, there's a huge loop on the back of the hook. Fished in conjunction with a 25 pound boom hook link, spinner rig style. Caught loads of fish on that and they were absolutely nailed. When I fished in Germany with Daryl a couple of years ago, we were fishing over loads of boilie and a bit of maize as well. And the wafters over the top of that really ruled the roost there. And another way I like to achieve that same thing is by drilling a bait out a little bit, putting a little bit of cork inside it, and then topping it off with a bit of pop-up fake corn. But that on top of a 15 miller over the top of a load of boilies, I think it's just a little bit more sight attraction being a different colour, a little bit more smell attraction because obviously they've got flavour inside them, and I soak them in goo as well. Normally I fish those on a combi rig, so my old faithful 20 pound hybrid stiff, strip a bit of that away near the hook. You know, either have the hair running up and down the hook on a ring or tying another whipping knot up the top of the hook. Just so basically the hair exits the hook where the barb would be. If I'm going to use it barbless, I'll use a size 4 claw because I think they're much more secure. If I'm going to use it barb, I use a size 4 long shank X again. With the hair coming off at that same point, the hook holds were absolutely fantastic. But if I'm using barbless, I always like to have a curved in point because I think it just stays in that bit better. And the last classic way to create a slow sinking hook bait is a snowman. Now, I like to cut a little bit off the top of the bottom bait, a little bit off the bottom of the pop-up, so the two join together so they look almost like one bait. When the fish are a little bit finicky, I think it just looking like one bait with a little bit more colour and a little bit more smell can get you more bites. But, you know, I would imagine the Snowman has probably caught more carp than any other rig. If you take the whole of Europe, the whole of the world into account, I think the Chod rig is a mile behind, the Spinner rig is probably a mile behind, and the Snowman is probably number one. So you've got loads of options there to fish bottom bait. I think if you give them a little bit of buoyancy, even if you're just drilling them out a bit and putting a bit of cork in and tipping them off with nothing, I think that just gives you a little bit of an advantage. So if the fish does get away with it, the rig will reset.
Following the exact same tactics as I had been on the final day I was away one last time.
I think it's in. Certainly clearing the lake of weed. And there we go, another absolute pearler from Phil's Lake. Unfortunately, it's the end of my session now, but I do sincerely hope that all the information I've passed on puts extra fish in your landing net. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you on the bank sometime.